Natarajan. He's a delivery manager with the Ford Technology Services India, with 15 years experience, overall industry experience in information technology in variety of domains. He manages application solutions development for human resources and the Office of General Counsel skill team of Ford globally from Chennai. He holds bachelor's degree engineering electronics and executive degree in general management from MIT Sloan School of Management, Cambridge, Boston, MA. He is serving as a director training in ISACA Chennai chapter board and also as a trainer in ISACA Chennai chapter for CISA and LIBA courses. He has undertaken many speaking engagements on various facets of cyber security and lead the cyber security special interest group of ISACA Chennai chapter, FCE Chennai and various conferences in and around Chennai. He holds CISA, CISSP, GCFCA, ITIL Foundation, CCNA, CCSA, and CCSE certifications. With this, I conclude my introduction. Now I invite Mr. Balachandra Natarajan. Please handle the session. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. Thank you. Okay, so long day hopefully for many of you. I hope I will add value. I'm sure about that. Let me see. So the topic given to me today is to talk about fraud risk management. You as a chartered accountant professional, you'll be definitely well aware on the nuances of the fraud risk management. What I'm going to touch upon this is with respect to the technology front and how the ERM can be integrated with FRM and what are the nuances in terms of handling the overall FRM part in terms of prevention as well as from detection. I tried to build a few slides which will be of good interest. So let's see how it goes. Feel free to stop in between when you have questions. My one of the endeavor of this session for the next probably 90 to 120 minutes is to bring some sort of conversational value mutually. That will be my key forte. So let's see how it goes. And feel free to stop by when you have a question. So with that, once again, a warm welcome to everyone. And thanks to Mr. Vittal Raj and Institute of Chartered Accountants India for giving me this opportunity. Okay, so as usual, some disclaimers. Though I work as a full-time employee in Ford Motor Company in the IT division, whatever I'm going to talk here, these are all basically on my personal capacity in terms of my understanding and knowledge related to fraud and fraud risk management and enterprise risk management. I'm cautiously not taking any greater examples and help from my work experience from Ford, so there is nothing directly linked with my work. So that's what this overall disclaimer is leading towards. If there is some sort of similarity which you could correlate, that will be merely coincidental. So with that as a disclaimer, let's get into that. A pretty straightforward agenda, right? So we will start with why are we sitting here and trying to discuss about FRM and what is the umbrella where it covers under ERM. So some sort of statutory references for your refreshing, and then we will start about discussing the frameworks. We'll take some examples on the recent fraud examiner report in 2016. 2017 is yet to come out. So 16 we will take it, and then we will have a bioscopic lens review on what are the finer points which we should be worried about and learn about. And then we'll also understand what is the sort of fraud risk management framework which we are trying to suggest, and what are the anatomy of that FRM. And we'll also see some fraud scenarios which many of us might be familiar with even during the auditing cycles as well. So mostly we will spend some sort of 30 to 30 minutes plus in the fraud scenarios, and rest of the items we will have something close to 45 minutes to 60 minutes. So that's the overall dissemination plan. Okay. Though the Q&A post in the last, I once again request you, when you have a sort of question, no need to hold, please raise your hand and we will try to answer that. And if I couldn't, I'll take back and then I'll come back to you later. Okay. All set? Fine. Shall we proceed? Awesome. Okay. Statutory reference of enterprise risk management. The background context starts with the Companies Act 1956, where enterprise risk management was not actually mandatory. However, the later updates have very specific requirements for the companies to comply with. So the board and the audit committee have been vested with specific responsibilities in assessing the robustness of the enterprise risk management framework, policy, systems. So that actually drives the overall compliance requirements into three paradigms. One is section 134, but before spelling out, I just want to submit kindly, I'm not a CA, okay? So I'm purely from IT industry. All these are all my learning references. So if you ask me certain nuances in the Companies Act and all, I may not be able to answer. So just forgive me. This is more for my learning as well. So there are three points where the compliance requirements demands an holistic ERM, which is required by board and audit committee. Section 134, where the board of directors report must include a statement indicating development and implementation of risk management policy for the company, including identification of elements of risk, if any, in which the opinion of board may threaten the existence of the company. Okay, so that covers the 134. 177 describes about the responsibility bestowed on audit committee. Shall act in accordance with terms of reference specified in writing by the board, which shall inter alias include evaluation of risk management system. So periodically independent review by the audit committee also is mandatory, and provide comments to the board. And finally, schedule 4 talks about the independent directors should satisfy themselves that systems of risk management are robust and defensible to protect the existence of the company. So those are the three things where it is getting bounded how the enterprise risk management getting the forte into the enterprises. This FRM is actually a part and parcel of the overall risk management for the company, because it assures the existence of proper operations. Okay, so few considerations which we have to be aware of is board, independent directors and executive management must assess risks arising from external factors, the various factors which we can consider, even including black swan, economic conditions, regulatory, competitive and etc., while evaluating the robustness of risk management systems existing in the enterprise. Executive management needs to specifically have a embed risk management across all business verticals and critical support functions, which needs to be identified, and then it has to have, and make risk management as everyone's responsibility, means the person who is holding the responsibility for delivering the top line and also secure the bottom line. Link risk management to business performance of the company. So these are the three key considerations the executive management has to ensure we have it in place. Some sort of, you know, theory so far. So now comes the real practice here. So this slide, where I took it as if from a paper from E&Y. So this is their call out on the enterprise risk management. Pretty robust one, according to me, in terms of coverage. There are around 9 aspects in the overall ERM the people are mentioning. The first is when the risk management approach is called to action, they have to first assess the adequacy and robustness of your existing risk management policy and systems. So that's step number one. Then align your risk management framework with business objectives and strategy so that you can able to assess what is your current risk levels. Then identify and refresh your risk universe, including existing and emerging ones, emerging risk area. So thereby you are more covered in terms of the existence. And then followed by use the technology to monitor and assess the adequacy and develop mitigation plans for the risk which you have identified, which will impact the business performance, and subsequently evaluate the impact and likelihood on a periodic basis, something like quarterly business performance feedbacks into risk analysis, and followed by rewards and recognitions to encourage people who are driving those risk management principle, and also enable board and audit committee to independently evaluate the robustness of risk management processes and systems. And finally, prepare the board of directors report detailing elements of risk that can impact business performance. So comprehensively, this 9 steps actually forms the broader outlook from an ERM space. You may have a sort of, you know, slight scratch in your head. Hey, this guy came here for FRM and then he talks a lot of ERM, but actually FRM is part of that. So ERM, so that's the reason I started with that. Now comes the couple of catchy ones, right? So we are very aware, right? Early bird catches the worm. When there is a fraud, you have to, as quick as possible, you have to detect it. And then it's more about how cautiously you are having your systems, you are making your preventive controls into the one. There is also a sort of interesting corollary, right? The second mouse actually get the cheese, right? So so how important your preventive is also having a very great importance for your detective controls to detect fraud. So the reason why I want to bring it this analogy is to understand the importance of preventive and detective controls, which we need to embed into our fraud risk management framework. Okay. Starting with fraud, we may be very aware of the three basic principles in fraud, right? Fraud triangle. One is the pressure. The organization, individuals who may be going under tremendous pressure for accomplishing the objectives, that could be the reason why they started committing fraud. So that's the cause, right? Pressure. And the second one is about the opportunity. You have loopholes in terms of process, policies, and system glitches, where it give the loophole for the person to commit the fraud. That's the opportunity. So you are giving the ability for an individual to commit a fraud. So that is the next attack vector. And then the third one is the sort of rationalization. I am associated with this for so long, and it's okay, it's just few dollars or few rupees, that's fine, it's okay. So that's the sort of, you know, rationalization. I'm in a very critical situation, my wife is at risk, my children is at risk, or something, some situation personally, so I can just do a malfunctioning and then try to take it later, and so on. So these are the three key parameters in terms of committing fraud. So pressure related with the cause, opportunity relates with the giving ability, and rationalization comes with a sort of justification. So that's defined in the fraud triangle like this. Combination of pressure, rationalization, and opportunity actually give a attack vector to commit a fraud. Now, so what is this picture depicts you? There's a huge traffic jam, right? So in big organizations, this will be the basic scenario, right? You will have a lot of things going on in parallel. Too many items, where to focus, how to focus, and why to focus on certain things and why to omit on certain things. So that challenge will be always there. how will you now indicate this fraud? How will you detect this? How will you prevent this? So this challenges we will be always facing when we try to see a big picture, and you are not alone. So every company has its own challenges. Feeling lost in crowd and you are not alone in the big scheme of things is always there. But all the crucial factor is understanding some sort of, you know, personality traits which are involved with the critical business functions. Just a second. So personality traits, pressure, behavioral changes actually will be the focus areas. The people who are extremely bestowed with the key responsibilities needs to be quantitatively and qualitatively monitored in terms of their actions as per the company norms actually plays an important role. For example, a person who is dealing with purchasing needs to go through a conflict of interest submission so that reasonably you can take an assurance that he don't have any vested interest while he is negotiating deals on the behalf of the company, right? So that's the sort of approach which we are trying to see through. Personality traits, pressure on which the person is running towards, and behavioral changes will be our focus areas predominantly on the fraud indicators. A very interesting fact from PwC report, fraud, the enemy within. Nearly two-thirds of the respondents to the fraud survey in India reported that fraud was perpetrated by employees. So that is one of the key risks which we as a chartered accountants, from an auditing standpoint, from an assurance standpoint, which we need to keep it in mind while we are going to provide the assurance report or the fraud investigation reports. So we need to be aware of it, and we need to see whether the company which we are trying to evaluate is having enough policy, enough monitoring controls and reporting mechanism, enough technology supporting systems to ensure that whether they are adequately can able to prevent and detect wherever it is applicable from a system level on the fraud risks. So there are few points which I would like to mention here. The one is importance of conducting periodic fraud risk assessments. This is definitely different from the regular accounting related audits which we will conduct, or SOX assessments audits which we will conduct. So there will be specifically targeted to fraud risk assessments which we need to do, and you can have a fraud risk checklist as well. So periodic fraud risk assessments and fraud horizon is the importance, right? So these are the importance. And then the second one is about the strong and periodic risk management at both cultural and control levels remains unquestionable. So this is the second one. And then the third one links with organizations that are vigilant, aware of the fraud risks, and conduct periodic fraud risk assessments will be better prepared to address the risk of fraud than the ones who did not pay adequate interest and time and investment on those fraud risk assessment and monitoring measures. So these three key points: the first one is important of periodic risk assessments, second one is having a strong risk management at cultural and control level, and then the third one is organizations that are vigilant and aware of the fraud risk and conduct those periodic risk assessment as per the point one are better prepared to address the issues and risks related with fraud. With that, the next one, this is a sort of, you know, interesting figure. So what we are seeing on the surface may not be the same, right? We need to see how the currents are moving, from which direction to which direction. So that is what the depiction which I'm trying to bring in. We have to spot the trends. Where is the circles moving, right? So fraud prevention and detection should have the focus on where are the nerve points where we should be putting the controls, and how periodically we have to ensure that these are all being evaluated. So now I'm going to bring some further anatomy with a sort of ABC company. So we all understand the fraud triangle, right? pressure, which relates with ability, and which relates with cause, and then opportunity, which relates with ability, and rationalization, which relates with judgment. So this is the fraud anatomy, and then that drives the person with the fraud indicators of personality traits, pressure and behavioral changes, which actually having a greater impact on the leader's role in detecting and preventing fraud opportunities, means conducting periodic risk assessments. So that's what the and a key point which I would like to and a share here. So here I would like to show you sort of, you know, interesting YouTube video trial. Actually, it is a sort of some supplier who is trying to provide a sort of product demo. So please ignore the last few seconds where he will be coming up with and saying that. But overall, the 3 minutes content is very useful. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run this video. Interestingly, this laptop and also my laptop is not catching the audio as well as video together. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run the audio from my iPhone. I'll run the video from here. I'll try to synchronize as much as I can. I think, you know, you can sail through. So give me that and let me do that. Okay, so here I'm going. Sorry, sir.
Commerce and banking channels are multiplying and providing consumers more ways to transact than ever before. From physical channels like credit, debit and prepaid cards, checks, ATMs and point of sale terminals, to digital channels like ACH, wire, internet, telephone, mobile devices and cryptocurrencies. Consumers, businesses, merchants and financial institutions all benefit from anytime, anywhere commerce. But there's a dark side. Sophisticated fraud threats are multiplying even faster. Malware and Trojans, account takeover and identity theft, credit abuse and bust-out scams, ACH and wire fraud, data breaches, money laundering, and employee fraud. In fact, a single data breach can compromise tens of millions of account holders in a matter of seconds. These threats put consumers, businesses, merchants, and banks at risk for sudden and potentially huge financial losses. They slow commerce and inhibit business growth and damage reputations, customer trust, and loyalty. While everyone should do their part in fraud prevention, the responsibility for protection falls onto banks and merchants and is compounded by mounting national and international regulations and compliance mandates. You must act fast to keep up with the onslaught of threats. This means getting payments risk management systems up and running quickly in order to thwart fraudulent transactions in real time before they're completed, perform sub-second analysis of enormous transaction volumes, assess typical and non-typical behavioral profiles, identify and address new threats immediately and at a sustainable cost, all while minimizing customer impact. Some companies try to build their own fraud management tools. This can be very expensive and puts a huge burden on them to try and stay ahead of fraudsters' sophisticated attacks. Focused point solutions can be effective for specific channels and threats, but they don't provide a 360-degree view of the customer's accounts and relationships. So, what do you need? A real-time, cross-channel fraud management solution with a flexible approach to integration with payment, banking, and commerce platforms. A solution with rapid implementation, which produces results from day one, one which leverages shared data and performs real-time analytics as threats evolve and facilitates easily defining and implementing new rules based on best-in-class financial crime management intelligence. A solution which allows consumers to engage in the fight against fraud through real-time alert options, all supported by a global team of fraud and risk analysts with deep domain expertise and access to global fraud intelligence. To learn how the UP Payments Risk Management solution can help you protect your customers, your reputation, and your bottom line.
So the message here which I would like to share is the importance of integrating your systems with the enablers for fraud detection and prevention mechanisms. So, and that requires a sort of larger focus when the scale of your industry is increasing like anything. Okay, so that's the point which I would like to drive here in this line. So now, so the first segment where I would like to bring you a sort of a broader perspective from an ERM angle and an FRM angle is now done. I'm now getting into the recent 2016 fraud examiner report where we will see some various dimensions on how the fraud has been committed worldwide, how is the distribution and so on. So prior me going there, I would like to give a pass here. Any questions so far? Okay, fine. So this is the start from the report. So in the next slides, I'm giving you the links as well. So this is called ACFE, Association of Certified Fraud Examiners. So it's a worldwide body which provides an annual report which comprehensively covers how is the fraud overall happening and then what is the anatomy of the frauds in various dissections and so on. So it's almost a 75-page report. So I pulled in around 10 specific parameters where we from an auditing angle will be really interested and focused on, so that you know that will be useful for us while we are seeing some red flags during our scheme of FRM or ERM audits. So the first one is a pretty interesting one. Initial detection of occupational frauds. I'm watching this space for at least for the past around 7 to 8 years in this fraud risk management space. So tip by an internal employee or by an unknown employee or an external person is the topmost one. Consistently, if you see 2012, 2014, 2016, all the 3 years, if you see the percentage is slowly decreasing, but tip is the primary primary way, methodology where we are get to know about the fraud existence. There is some fraud which is happening. So what is extremely important here is we need to have those sort of mechanism available. For example, there should be a sort of anonymous hotline or email where you can write it. So those sort of provisions needs to be there so the respective whistleblower can comfortably come and report it out, keeping them anonymous. So that's the first one. Next is during internal audits, where you can see some trend. And interestingly, that internal audits discovery of fraud is slightly increased when compared to the last couple of years. And then in management review, actually it is getting lesser when compared to the 2014 review. And then by accident, accounts reconciliation, others is having a very significant increase when compared to 2014. In 2014, in others, it was 0.5, that increased to 5.5. So there were some details provided on what are those other factors which doesn't come under any of these classifications. Document examination, external audit, notified by law enforcement, surveillance and monitoring, IT controls, and confession. So all these are the key sort of takers. So the main gravity is revolving around TIP. and internal audit and management reviews. So these three constitute close to almost 75%, 16, 12, and then almost 50 plus. So almost 75% forms about this. So based on the 80-20, we should focus enormous interest on all these three areas, how the people, whistleblowers, can feel comfortable and then highlight when there is a issue in the company. So that mechanisms needs to be there. So from here, I'm just sharing the link as well so that you know you can always verify. So the people who have participated are all certified fraud examiners, CFEs. In the typical organization, they are losing 5% of their revenues in a year as a result of the fraud. This is the sort of metric which they are trying to post it. So imagine sort of 1.5 billion means 1 plus billion revenue, even 5% is a very substantial figure, right? So that much of worth of fraud and it could exist apparently. So there is a responsibility the management and audit and board has to go and see that their fraud detection and prevention controls are there. In the cases detected by TIP at organization with formal fraud reporting mechanisms, telephone hotlines were the most commonly used, 39.5%. However, TIP submitted via email also holds almost 34%, and web-based online forms holds close to 23.5%, combined to make reporting more common through the internet than by telephone. So that actually, it's quite intriguing. Via email and online put together is surpassing the hotline. So that's what the message here is. And in the left-hand side, and the overall thing, in the year of 2016, 6.3 billion total losses have been reported by fraud. And then in that, around 23% of cases caused losses of 1 million or more to the parent organization due to fraud. There is a median loss per case. On an average, when you try to take a median loss, it's around $150,000 per case, which organization is losing their thing. And whistleblowers were most likely to report fraud to their direct supervisors, close to around 20.6% of cases, and then company executives to around 18%. So those are the interesting findings. So the next one is about how the overall fraud detection they are disseminating. It's quite like a refresher for us. There are three broader areas where fraud is disseminated. One is first comes under the corruption angle. So that can be handled in terms of conflicts of interest, where you will run at things in terms of self-disclosure by the company and properly investigating where people are handling the crucial cases, something like purchasing schemes, sales schemes, all these things where how the people involved have any vestigial interest. The second one is bribery. Invoice kickbacks and bid rigging are the places where we need to tighten up. And then next is illegal gratuities, taking undue favors. In that, and then economic extortion, predominantly it's involved around lobbying in a different side. So that's from the corruption angle. From the asset misappropriation angle, we'll take it through the next slide. And then the last one is on the financial statement side. So we have net worth and net income overstatements. So as an accounting people, you will be very familiar on the items on this. And then next one is on the network understatements. One is the overstatements, next is an understatement. So there are various pointers where and we have given on that. Okay, so the next one is on the asset misappropriation. So that has two broader classification. One is on the inventory part, and next is on the cash part. In the cash part, theft of cash on hand, theft of cash on interest, and then fraudulent disbursements constitutes the major segments. And then there are minor segments where what are the different types of fraud opportunities exist. In the inventory part, we have misuse and larceny. So these are the ways they are mentioning the fraud angles. This is another interesting one, according to me. So how much of frequency and how is the median loss of the overall fraud from a world perspective? If you see, you can see a sort of, you know, greater concentration of the frequency and median loss in terms of Southern Asia and Asia Pacific. In terms of the overall value, you can see a lot happening on the Sudan and the Middle East, Israel related area, where around $500,000 with a median of almost close to 57%. Next fall under Latin America, close to almost $400,000. And then comes Western Europe with $300,000. And then we have followed by US and Canada, 250 and 200. Interestingly, the Asia Pacific from an eastern angle holds close to around 285, and Southern Asia, which is focused on the India part, it's saying almost close to 172. So that's the interesting thing. The next one is duration. On what duration these valuations are coming out? Frequency and median loss based on the duration of fraud. 6 months comes with almost lesser value, around 45K, with a median loss percentage of close to around 26.4. And when it is having the largest span, more than 60 months, the valuation still goes almost close to 850K. So that's the range of distribution. So as the more the time the fraud exists till its discovery, the losses will be more. It's exactly correlating that. And then it comes the area where this predominantly happens. Interestingly, if you see payroll in the year 2016 report, most of these top five items, payroll, check tampering, financial statements, fraud, expense reimbursements, and billing, more or less all these are hovering somewhere around close to 24. Okay. And interestingly, payroll had a bigger hit in 2012. It has a huge impact. However, in the last couple of instances, in 2014 and 16, it remains the same, close to 24. So the same have an impact in the check tampering as well. However, the rest of the financial statements, expense reimbursement and billing part, it retains the same. Skimming is another credit card related fraud. That is also there. Cash larceny and corruption, cash on hand, these are also predominant ones where they are detecting frauds in these areas. Next comes our source of tips for the detection of frauds. Employees holds against the a key percentage, close to almost 51% of employees, they are playing the role as a whistleblower. Next comes, interestingly, the customer, and then with some anonymous and other opportunities, followed by vendors, share and stakeholder and competitor. So interestingly, the second place is comes to the customer. So customer detects something and then they just report it out, also comes into the picture. This is another thing which actually, you know, intrigued me. Criminal background of the perpetrator who is committing fraud. 88.3% who have been detected of committed fraud were not never charged before or convicted before. They are new guys. So there is a lot of new people which you can encounter during that. Means typically what it implies is that the person, you may not think this person will most likely will commit a fraud. There is a possibility that that person may commit because of the fraud triangle, pressure, opportunity, and rationalization. So that is a sort of indication. And very less percentage who had prior conviction and then charged but not convicted and so on. So almost close to 88, lopsided view. So that actually indicates us an importance of investing on technology part for identifying the frauds in the timely manner. So this is another key item which the board can consider. So those are the sort of interesting few slides which I have from the fraud report. So the detailed report you can always download from here. It is available for everyone, so you can go through that. I'd like to give a pass here probably. So any questions so far? Yes, please. System will not have. Okay, thank you. Yeah, nice catch. Systems won't have a distinguished difference between a single time fraud or already. So by putting the right control measures with the help of the technology, you can start monitoring 24/7 and start identifying an anomalies in a more deeper way when compared to the manual methods, and especially the places where we have to rely on the cash handling, the commercial things handling, all the three broader perspectives on the fraud part. So the focus will be the more and more we use technology that helps you from a prevention angle and also helps you for detecting as well. Many times the right person who have been bestowed for performing the right duty are committing fraud, and that person never committed fraud before, and he is supposed to do that job, so he will have all the access rights. Then what else will able to help you to do that? Detection is the only way. So your system should have a mechanism so that it detects clearly the person, at what time he or she logged in, at what angle, what are the actions they performed, and so on. So that is the angle which I try to focus. Yes, especially the high value risk items, whether it is a compliance requirement or it's a financial statements or it is a cash receiving receivables and payables and so on, where you can easily do the money transactions and where they are bestowed for that and purchasing per se. Yep. Technology is a key here. So and every report which is suggesting an FRM, they are asking us to go behind the technology with the recent innovations in the big data, that also those things also getting more easily. So you can build in some sort of AI algorithms in terms of identifying how that mining can do better. The way now they are do a cross-selling, right? So the Amazon do a cross-selling and so on. The same thing, fraud also we can able to do that with those AI tools, predictive algorithm tools, with the help of artificial intelligence. Thank you for the question. Yes, sir. The first one is about the India's fraud indication position. We are not to the level where the external environment is, as we have seen in the overall region by region report out, we are hardly 1/5 of the fraud levels when compared to the global scenario. So that's the exact data pointer which I could deduce, because that is also one of my key areas of focus. So that is one. And then the second one is how the Indian companies are investing in FRM. Predominantly all the leading companies which are striking the bell in the stock markets, they invest a lot in FRM, predominantly on the global level tools. And these are all coming as a software as a service nowadays. And they also employ a sort of fraud risk assessments by a third party, which help them to provide an independent assessment, avoid collusions inside the one. So typically their audit committee and the internal audit committee subscribes that this is the thing. And they actually investing on the day-to-day forensic management tools is not as heavy as the external environment, especially the US, Canada, and other thing. But what they are doing is they are going for a leading consulting companies or risk assurance companies or fraud risk management companies, and they use the tools and then they try to take the logs and feed it into their thing and then provide the report. So that's the thing. Integrating the overall FRM into that in the comprehensive manner, BFSI is one area where we are scaling very high, and the manufacturing is the area where we are not at all getting there in a more inner way. Yep. There are more self-assessments are still the norm. When I'm talking about that, we will have a fraud risk assessment questionnaire, and then people from the different business heads, they will be asked to fill up that on a periodic basis, and then they will get that. So that's the sort of norm we are following. Whereas in the BFSI, FRM is fully integrated. All the banks, credit cards, and investment banking, all these, they are using their FRM tools integrated into their component. Yeah. Yes, please. Frauds never detected, I don't know, means whether someone has a prediction. definitely not. So the report out is happening on this. No focused. It is something like, you know, whether can we live a life in Mars now or not. Potential, you are saying. Assessment of frauds which are there but have never been detected. See, the initial data pointer, if you see, there was an interesting data pointer we started with that. So, 6.3 billion, and the 5-1 is something like 5% of the revenues in a year, in a typical organization, is having a vulnerability on that fraud. But you can argue both sides. We have to take it with a pinch of salt. Yeah.
Again, you're talking only about corporate fraud.
Yes. This seminar, I'm not going to focus on political frauds. Definitely enterprise and corporate frauds, yes, it is in the... But very good question. I'm not an expert on the political fraud analysis.
You can't say corporate frauds affect us and other frauds don't affect us.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Any other? Yes, sir. Okay. Can I put a reverse question here? Because most of us here are all auditors, right? Interestingly, I played a role of IT auditing in Ford. So I had a stint of almost 4 years in global auditor's office in Ford. So little familiar from the IT angle. How many of you believe that the regular audit can really be beneficial from a detection of fraud angle? How many of you? So maybe one. How many of you believe? partially. So, okay. In spite of having technology and system, the regular normal audit, for example, you are performing a technology audit or you are performing a business audit, say accounts reconciliation, how much we will be looking from an auditing angle whether there is a fraud happened. So that's what my question is. It is a sort of 50-50 because there is a lot of human value involved in that. The person who is auditing, if that person has a good experience and good understanding of the fraud elements, then he will start looking at that. And again, a very capable person, due to the constraint of the time, he or she may not able to do that. So to answer your question, my view is it's highly personified, time bound, and challenging. A regular contemporary audit will never give you a sort of assurance in terms of fraud angle, and that's what even many of the people are suggesting. You cannot take your regular audit cycle report and take that, no, my company is okay, I'm fraud risk taken care. You have to do a fraud risk assessment specifically, which will give you that relative assurance, double quotes. So is that fine, or you are still having your doubts? Personifying lot of things, whatever you mention, a very good auditor with a reasonable time, and he can sense things, he can smell things, but with the young generation coming in and so on, so I doubt. Your dedicated fraud risk management, fraud risk assessment audits can yield maximum value, not a contemporary audits. Very good question, sir. Thank you. Yeah, you see, example is Satyam, right? So, yeah. See, that is where the fraud risk angles and then the independent auditors assessment. So the third particle, the session 134, 177, and then the third, schedule 4. See, that's where those comes into the picture, and the amount of independence we are giving to the audit committee when they have seeing all these challenges, when the board of the chairman of the company where they are suspecting, what should they do? So that's the sort of, you know, challenge. Smaller companies, I don't think so. It can be a vanilla version. It needs to be handled in a little means deeper way, in terms of shrinking certain pieces and expanding certain pieces based on the volume we are talking. So smaller company means obviously it will be a SME band, and they will always have a sizable portion to contribute to the deeper things. So technology infusion will have a maximum value proposition when compared to the regular fraud risk assessments and so on. That is the integral part, right? FRM should have all these risk parameters identified and have controls to monitor on an ongoing basis and try to indicate as a fraud risk indicator. My view is, I'm also very much inclined to that. If I'm seriously concerned for that XYZ company, which is not paying adequate importance in their annual report, you can raise it in the in their annual stockholders meeting. Or you can write a letter to that guy, company secretary. Write a letter and then why it is something like that, and they have to flag it out. They have the obligation to flag it out. Put a copy to SEBI, obviously that will take care. So, very crude answer, but I never did that. But this is the sort of reception I'll get. Mm. Great questions. Sometimes I feel so ill that I'm having that, because these are the things which I never thought. It's just my, yeah. You are actually nailing the head. Because with the recent invasion in the mutual industry, everywhere, every one of us are investing a lot in mutual funds. There's a lot of related risk. Everyone comes up with the sort of, you know, report, and then we are just glued with their annual statements, with various companies we subscribing on that. We never know whether the risk assurance and the report which they are providing is comprehensive enough. Touch wood. So happily complicated. Hmm?
Yeah.
Mm. It will make sure that you are confused so that you will leave at some point in time. Hmm. Any other? Okay. So this frame risk management, fraud risk management framework, this is actually Deloitte's one. So while I was reading this paper, I compared with at least, you know, all the four big fours paper, and then I found it very convenient and very comprehensive. So that's the reason I pulled in this. I'm not advocating the big four here, neither it is EY or nor it is Deloitte, but I found it very impressive. So the one which I would like to focus here is the way they tried to navigate the overall FRM institutionalized into our company processes. So they go like this. So they say the diagnosis, detect, recommend, continuous and periodic monitoring, develop fraud response plan, investigate the cases. So this is monitoring, report and monitoring. So this is the mechanism which they are trying to devise it. And typically, you know, it is the fraud risk management where they are providing an insight on how you have to do a fraud prevention, detection, and response mechanism comprehensively. And these points are the critical ones. What I'll do is I'll try to read it out. Evaluate the current under the diagnosis, because I know the people who are sitting in the back, it will be very tough. Even from here to monitor, I'm facing a challenge. Okay, so the first one is about diagnosis. Evaluate the current status and effectiveness of the organization anti-fraud control. This involves assessing the culture, attitude, and awareness amongst employees about their knowledge of and response to any issues of fraud and misconduct. So that's the first part in terms of diagnose. In terms of detect gaps in anti-fraud controls, evaluate management's existing fraud risk management framework to detect potential gaps of anti-fraud controls in the processes. Establish fraud risk profiles by analysis and ranking of fraud risks as high, medium, low against existing anti-fraud controls. So that's on the detecting part. And then the recommend mitigation anti-fraud controls, recommend enhancement of existing controls or mitigating anti-fraud controls for implementation based on anti-fraud control gaps detected. The same thing from the continuous and or periodic monitoring. Enable continuous monitoring of controls using technology. Perform forensic data analytics of transactions periodically at the process level to alert management at fraud signals. And then develop fraud response plan, FRP. Develop a fraud response plan to address cases of alleged or confirmed fraud ones. Investigate cases of alleged or confirmed fraud. So this is on the development part, and the last one is on the investigation part. Assist in the investigation of cases of alleged or confirmed fraud within the organization. Incorporate identified fraud risks and schemes into fraud risk management framework based on findings from investigation. So this is the way they try to synchronize the overall thing. Diagnose, detect, response, detect, response, response. This is the way they overall synchronize that. Pretty comprehensive one, according to me, in terms of overall continuous improvements from a diagnose angle, from a detect angle, from the respond angle. This is a sort of, you know, closer view on the culture part, which actually, you know, intrigues a lot. What is this culture from the organizational view standpoint when we are doing an FRM audit? Web-based survey to understand the ethical culture of an organization. And fraud awareness training. How is that conducting? How is the responses? How quickly people are taking that? How many people are not completed yet? And within how many years of joining in the work and so on. And conduct a whistleblower system assessments and benchmarking. Even there are places where they do some sort of, you know, cross-check. They will commit something and then they will wait to see whether someone comes and tells that and so on. So that's about the testing on the culture part. And then on the data and technology part, forensic data analytics to identify transaction anomalies. When it is in the banking domain, BFSI domain, it will be predominantly one. E-commerce, it will be predominantly one. And unusual patterns, computer forensics, that capability of the company to supplement this from a technology angle. And then the third one is on the controls, fraud vulnerability diagnostic, FRM, tools used to evaluate anti-fraud controls. Business intelligence services, corporate fraud investigations, and so on. So these are the sort of, you know, controls they will be looking for. We'll get to now into the fraud prevention measures. Predominantly, I subclassified into three broader areas. First is human resources, where we will be recommending people to perform some background investigations for critical positions, anti-fraud training to be given, and evaluating the performance and ensure that they are compliance in that. Conduct exit interviews when people are leaving the organizations. Try to probe more when there is a dissatisfaction to the apex. That helps us to identify whether there are something fraud which is happening inside. That is from the human procedures, human resources procedure point of view. Second is authority limits and separation of duties. Careful dissemination of authority in terms of providing the limits, especially the DOA, delegation of authority. Subsequently, we will have a sort of, you know, DOA which is running from top till the threshold levels. So most of the maximum items will be delegated to the lower ones, and then we will say it is already approved in that, and that's the reason they are doing, and then the top management will have lesser visibility on that. So that needs to be carefully worked out, and whenever there is a DOA exists, there should be a rational people have to come out and say, and that should not be for an infinite period or a longer period. That person is on vacation for a couple of weeks, so he's not there, or he's on sick, so that person has a thing. And DOA, to my greater knowledge, cannot go beyond a regular vertical or a skill team. Your purchasing team cannot give a DOA to marketing and sales. So those sort of gross errors needs to be taken care. And separation of duties is another area where we need to be very watchful out, especially in the cash and e-commerce related areas. Operational fraud, where in terms of documentation, it could be on any area today, in terms of Aadhaar fraud, in terms of credit card details fraud, in terms of PII, SPII details fraud, assessing organizations' fraud prevention mindset, and then continuous monitoring of the fraud prevention. So all these needs to be having an operational level control assessment periodically, and that needs to be independently assessed and reported out to the senior management. So that will be very effective. In terms of scenarios, I have put out almost close to around 9 scenarios. So the main thing what we'll be doing is we will try to be little participative, almost close to 1 hour. It's a sort of more or less gyan, but here what I tried is I pulled out around 9 scenarios and then try to have a sort of quick discussion how we could detect and prevent and protect. A quick reflect. So we'll start with conflict of interest, bribery, kickbacks, bid rigging, payroll, familiar one for everyone, intellectual property and SPI data theft, scrap scale arrangements, employees soliciting suppliers, planned purchase process, corruption and inadequate separation of duties, and shell company and theft. So these are the sort of 9 scenarios I have crafted it out. I will go one by one. We'll try to see how things goes. First one, conflict of interest. An employee hired to design and source a large program held undisclosed stock options in a private company, awarded a large contract. The employee was key to assessing the technical competence of the bidders. So now the question is, what is the likelihood you would detect these fraud using traditional internal control steps? Does your fraud evaluation internal controls detect this type of fraud? Participation. No yes or no answer. See, anyone can say yes or no, but the interest is, many of you are experts in this area. You might have already faced this. Feel free to have that sharing, because everyone else will be beneficial with that.
In the factory audit scenario, definitely not. In an internal audit scenario, you can.
Okay. Consider, I'm not going to talk here on statutory audit. Eliminate that. Waste of time. I'm not touching on the statutory here. Okay. So internal audit
internal
perspective.
Internal audit.
So if he acquires the stock after the hiring?
Again, as a set of behavioral watch,
he is not giving any clue indication. See, I'm not giving counter, I'm trying to think through, means so that we all will have all these challenges, right? One basic thing is self-assessment. See, self-assessment on a yearly basis for a purchasing guy, he is self-vouching that if there is a sort of vestigial interest, I will come and disclose. And if he lies in that, he has the responsibility. Company can produce that as a legal document. We did that. He undergone the conflict of interest training. So, and he committed that he is not involved in it when someone later on whistleblowed or something. Right? That is one reasonably detective part. But is there a preventive part here? Anyone have some Eureka idea? Bidding process. Okay.
If I am to check the bidding process, pre-bidding process, then I may evaluate the company and find out the reason, what could be the reason that he has been awarded the contract. Maybe that could know something.
But there are very few steps people would have done. See, for example, if it is $1 million contract, why I have to bestow on only one guy? I can appoint two independent verification and then aggregate the report and then try to take a concerted decision. That is a very basic thing, right? When I am going to award a sort of $100,000 contract or something like, I'll have some slabs. So I'll have two completely independent opinions and then run it. So having the collusion in that, that is extreme. But actually for this, I can always have a checks and balance. What else? Background check. Background check will detect this. Interesting. Okay. Any other? If it is really a big contract, companies like L&D, right? I heard that they do have a sort of ongoing fraud investigation for the ones which they are doing. They do a sort of, you know, background check on the people who are involved in it, and then how the overall, they do a sort of, you know, ongoing and a check. I don't know the more intricate details, but when L&T like of company, so when they do a big order, so only 3 or 4 people will be involved in it. There will be multiple lower level people who will be involved in bits and pieces, but the overall aggregation and then the final pricing, it will be very closely connected. So they all have to undergo the conflict management, conflict of interest vouching, and then they should disclose. And even if after they disclose, they will employ some third party one, and they keep on monitoring during that period of time, whatever the emails, mobile phones, which are involved in that personnel, that will be carefully monitored, and then DLP, data loss prevention. That mechanism is closely, so those are the ones which I learned. There are companies who are doing that for the most sensitive big orders and so on. Anyone here who has that sort of experience? Okay, so that's on the first one. Next one. A purchasing employee negotiated a percentage of increase in business for a supplier. The employee directed non-related businesses to pass their services through the supplier. The kickbacks payments to the employee were made to a consulting firm, consulting company. How will we detect this? Obviously, your internal control mechanism will be able to catch up this. The kickback payments to the employee were made to a consulting company. Officially, you will not have any records at all. How will you detect? Fraud is you are awarding a contract and then for that you are getting a kickback. Correct. I was expecting that question. Whether there is a price involvement pointer is there or not. Even though he allegedly informed that guy and then that guy put a L1. Let's assume. How will you detect? So he is at the L1, he has a business case drafted, everything is in the normal favor, then how will you detect? Is only by background and behavioral. Behavioral is the effective place here. Saying is easy, but very, very tough ones. That's where. That is another thing. Why every service is aggregated to one guy? then purchasing should ask an angle, who is recommending that? Why this guy is enforced for that? Then that will be a sort of, you know, counter argument, economies of scale. Okay, but if there is an L1, equal L1, why can't we de-risk it? See, that sort of, you know, cross-questioning and understanding will help us to understand whether there is a element of fraud opportunity exist. So concentration, over-concentration on a single supplier is always a risky one, and purchasing has to take a stand. We should decentralize, or we should break down into a couple of parts. So if someone shows a red flag, then it should sensitize, and especially when it comes from the higher management, because more and more the people at the top, hey, I know that guy, he will do it. You give the contract to them. How much the L1? So he will give 10% lesser. That's the way they sometimes, you know, do that. That's not right. it may be possible for a small company, but not a big company. Feel free to challenge me, because that's based on my limited auditing knowledge, but yeah, you can challenge me.
Are there tools to identify a red flag?
Behavior. Here I believe tools will be very, very...
Not like that.
Because they are very smart enough, right? They will make the L1 alignment.
So what I meant is, run the tool and take a report, and just see the report to see unusual, is it possible?
Okay.
See,
that's the reason I use the word called economies of scale. See, from a survey standpoint, people can always come back and substantiate all these related services I am basketing out for a single vendor, because I will get the economies of scale. And that guy is providing a good service, blah, blah, blah. Second indicator, according to me, is the service. The moment you are getting an inferior service, you should challenge out why this vendor is not getting replaced. So that is also another data pointer from where things can be initiated. If something going good, it's fine. But if you are paying something and then you are getting not a right thing, so not right level of service, then that needs to be challenged out. And if that is not getting changed even after a certain period of time, and the large chunk of work is still channelizing there, it's an element of fraud risk. Okay, second one, an ex-employee started an outside company, then was rehired. His new position enabled him to source business to his outside venture. Several fellow employees colluded in sourcing him additional business. Actually, this is pretty much, you know, exists, right? People go out, they start some ventures, they be a sort of either active investor or a sort of silent investor partner, and they get rehired because of whatever the connects they have, and then the parent company will start providing businesses to them, and he will be the back and forth for moving those things. To my knowledge and experience, if it is a big corporation, if they come to know, they will immediately sack that person. Immediately. Once they identify that, this is the sort of trend. Whether there is an actual thing happens or not, even sense the iota of it, they will immediately sack that person. Predominantly, this will get caught in the whistleblower one, something like that. Any other comments on the second one? Any interesting examples, experience? If it is advantageous to the company and the company is aware of it, and the conflict of interest states that I am part and parcel, I am getting a dividend out of it, and then I will not participate in the selection process. If that is the case, fair. That's where the difference is. The moment people do not identify this element in the conflict of interest, that's it. They take it as a source and then they will chuck it down. Those are all formal ones. See, is there a risk? Is there a fraud happening then? That's what the elementary question will be. Exactly. That happens actually. Especially in the big ones, they will invest and then there will be a return dividend and so on. So that happens. But all these confines to the purchasing agreement. So they will say that these are the rationals. This is the way they are circling the overall profit. Small scale, nothing will work. Small scale is a one-man show, more or less, here in India. True. Small, medium, we cannot consider. It will be a different paradigm. You will see many of this in each and everything. You have to be really, really careful before providing any assurance. Payroll. Should we do this or should we skip? Okay, I think silence is an acceptance, so let's do. Okay, an agency person convinced his supervisor that he was required to work daily overtime and weekends to complete work deliverables. The agency employee had a role in inflating work estimates and took credit for work performed by other persons while really working only 30 hours per week, not the 70 hours claim. How will we detect this? One basic parameter is consistently that guy will be getting the overtime. But should know. That's it. If that is not getting flagged and it is extended to the period of time, it's a sign of, even if it is systemically patternized in terms of every month that guy will get some X amount of hours. If there is a sort of pattern which is evolving, that needs to be cautiously seen through, and then why it is so and why the same person, why there is no work balance, why there is no comp off policy, and so on. And needless to say, this have a greater impact in the manufacturing space, where they will have OT in the manufacturing line, right? Probably in the white collars, we will not see much on that. the next one is about any other inputs on that? System, no, no, in system, it is possible. There are ways where a person who is expertised in the payroll system for almost 10 years, he can conveniently he can manipulate. There are chances. There are scenarios people have seen. And that will be on a very very tiny scale. Very, very tough. Ghost employee. Yeah, why not? But for ghost employees and all, it requires some collusion. These are all basic checks. Generally, the audit department, there will be audit department, they will do some cross verification and so on. Okay, so another employee that worked in the same area spent 40 hours per week at work. However, about 50% of the time was spent coordinating and performing work for an outside business venture. How will we detect? Supervisor. Yeah, supervisor. Actually, work colleagues also, they should sensitize, right? Again, that work productivity and all these lies with the supervisor. See, peers can complain, but supervisor should say, and if there is a conduit between that employee and the supervisor, then skip level or whistleblower should come out. But how many organizations do that deep dive verification from a data angle? How many, because I'm just articulating a situation. Most of the companies where you are seeing a white collar sort of jobs companies, they do exception payroll. they will not mark every day you work for 8 hours. They will say when you are leave, they will put leave, right? It's an exception payroll. It can be seen in the other way around also. It's a standard that 40 hours per week. Okay, fine. Let's move on. Oh, one more. Good. High overtime verification. This fraud could be detected by observing the work hours of persons with high overtime in the area. If observation is not practical, determine best way to verify on the person's routine, system logins, telephone usage, badge access, parking lot, inquires to co-workers, other known habits when arriving and department. So this is on the high overtime verification and usage of company assets. Although people are generally careful around co-workers in hiding non-office businesses during work hours, they usually slip up sometime. Items left out of copier, overheard conversations, seek business from co-workers, non-work computer activity, personal cell phone usage, and so on. So I think this is some sort of, you know, indication. Okay. Next one is intellectual property and SPI theft. A Chinese engineer downloaded company design documents and traveled to China to interview with prospective employers and provide stolen information. An employee was found, we'll stop at that. So how will we detect or prevent? What sort of ones will detect these? One, the first one, downloaded company design documents and traveled to another company for interview. and provide the stolen information. Okay, I'm a forensic guy. Okay, so I played the role of I'm a GCFA, GASE certified forensic analyst. Simple system log, it's not sufficient to prove in the court. So what is more important is your PCs, your laptops. First, it should have a sort of USB related controls. If there is a business need and the policy requirements allows the company to have the open USB ports, then there should be a sort of USB log storage sufficiently archived and pruned for its perfection. That is the only savior to prove you in front of court that this XYZ person with that specific system login have downloaded these files of this much size, this much MB, this much time to the mass storage device or via email or via whatever the mechanism. So that are the only logs which can save the company from arguing and then protecting their intellectual property. Any questions? Okay, so the next one is an employee was found to be looking up customer account PII and selling it to outside parties. Actually, all our telecom guys, credit card guys, everyone is doing this one, right? So we get a lot of calls. When we do something in some website, next minute, the same related types of calls we will be getting, right? So all this happening here. So how will we detect all these things? What type of fraud it is? Is it behavior? Print, access, taking printouts, taking screenshots, sending emails. Predominantly, this can be only handled via technology control, according to me. But anyone has a different view, please do share. According to me, the only way you can prove that person guilty in the court is via information technology support. So, okay, so move on. An ex-employee contacted a former co-worker to get confidential information he was not allowed to take when released. In return, he provided a graduate school recommendation letter. How will we detect? Whistleblower. Yeah. How I look at that is, there is a possibility from a system angle that person may say that, hey, I got released, but my login might have been still valid. They might not have removed my login within 30 days or something. So can you log in into my name and then try to? So the moment this happens, that logs can be used and then try to see. But your fraud detection technique should have that capability. I'm sorry? No. Nothing related to my... but I am aware, but I don't want to say that I have encountered and then we have seen and so on. These are all general ones. Any company, any fraud risk assessment should go through all these assessments. Okay. So last couple of ones. Thanks for... patiently going through this. Scrap weight. This fraud could be detected by observing the scrap process and noting that certain shipments were not being weighed. So this is on the scrap weight. How you have to observe that as an auditor and then see that. Scrap grades is observation may have detected the scrap of different values were often being mixed on shipments. That happens. And then cancelled billings is in other cases scrap was weighed properly prior to release from the plant. However, select shippers were intentionally coded as no charge or charged later to be non-billable and improperly cleared from accountable documents, with related accounts receivable being reversed. So all these are all will be indicators for scrap sales related ones. I think there is no question here. Employees soliciting this fraud, we can detect by surveying people in the area to determine if they were aware of any persons that may be soliciting or accepting any type of favors from suppliers, or if they may be aware of an unusually close relationships co-workers have with suppliers. So that's on the employee soliciting. And then kickback schemes, if there are any indications of solicitation or close personal relationships with suppliers, an attempt should be made to identify the key influencers and observe or inquire if there are any indicators the persons may be living beyond their means, like expensive vehicles and home renovations and pickup tabs and behavior change and frequent travels and so on. So kickbacks. So this is again another example. Several employees in a department that had questioning influence of certain production materials regularly solicited and accepted meals and other favors being offered by suppliers. In order to maintain good relations with employees, the suppliers felt obligated to entertain the employees and were reluctant to report the situation. Situation grew to a point where at least one employee received larger kickbacks from a supplier, including expensive equipment used in a family business. So all these will come out from a whistleblowing one, and there is a sort of internal rift they will have and so on. This is on the plan purchase PO description. This fraud could be detected by recognizing unusually vague miscellaneous descriptions are being used to increase the scope of what could be purchased on various line items. BO intent is, blank order is, review of release receipts could detected that the items being received did not always match the type of items were covered in the original intent of the blanket orders. And then re-invoicing is, the suppliers involved appeared to be further taking advantage of the situation by invoicing for the same items more than once. Difficult to prove if the receiver is not verifying the physical items. Reinvoicing is second time invoicing this for the same thing. Duplication. ERP or three-way matching. Your PO with the GRN with the payment release, all these three should be matched, approvals. That matching, if it is not happening, this will definitely will happen. And especially the production related materials has to go through the three-way matching, people generally say. What you order, what you got, and what you pay. So all these needs to be integrated. So purchasing personal in coordination with the buyer established POs and blanket orders that were set up to enable an unusually wide variety of items to be purchased. The favored suppliers were able to grow sales at multiple plan sites by delivering items that went well beyond the initial intent of orders. Manufacturing personnel were able to avoid handling of other required approvals, orders, and buyer benefited from suppliers providing travels and even tickets and other. Again, this is another tough one. Either the supplier or the other fellow employees, sort of whistleblower, has to come out here. So this is about the corruption and inadequate separation of duties. A facilities engineering supervisor was involved in requesting, planning, supervising and approving payments for a large tier one supplier that provided labor and various materials at a manufacturing site. The engineer made arrangements with an owner of a subcontractor to invoice the tier one for labor and other expenses that were not provided. The site management did not detect the fraud due to their trust in the engineering supervisor, and because the falsified expenditures were fully contained in the budget. So how will we detect this? Segregation of duties. So we have to involve at least, you know, two persons, some field engineer plus supervisor. So a sort of, you know, dual can able to reasonably detect this in a longer time. Yeah. T&M, time and material. Although a time and material internal check and a control checklist will with adequate review steps was available in the internal control checklist, was not deployed at this location. Physical review of badge access, contractor sign-ins, other evidences could have detected the fraud due to large discrepancies in the labor billings. Requester influence contacting buyer may have identified rubber stamp role of purchasing. That could have been a flag pointer. But many times in this, purchasing guys will act as a sort of rubber stamp. They will say you have to, you can go for a single supplier. All you have to do is single supplier, single source justification form, and go and get it from your higher authority. So that guy will say he is the only guy who is doing all these things, so they will sign it. A shell company was established by an IT employee responsible for procuring computer equipment for a manufacturing site. The IT person acquired plant-related items at inflated amounts along with personal items such as gaming components, video equipment and computers. Review of payments to the shell company made by Tier 1 and Tier 2 suppliers confirmed that the IT person signed and cashed the checks on the behalf of the shelf company. So this is the way they identify. Okay, so these are the scenarios. Any reflections, questions? Okay, so we will wind up now. Predominantly,
obviously.
Correct.
It is a human element.
Human element. That is where the maximum risk is all revolving around, and the only savior there is a sort of, you know, proper control steps with the help of technology. No, that means a lot. I beg to differ, but you have to be dedicated enough to conduct that fraud risk assessment. You should identify that these are the areas where the fraud can potentially occur, and I am going to invest some money for putting up someone to do that verification. Religiously, I have to do that. Okay, so the first one, we all know, right? So pressure, so massive changes in the society, that's adding pressure globally. Technology growth disrupting industries and augment manpower reduction, demands of higher skill level also contributing a lot in terms of providing identification of loopholes, understand the ability of the gaps in the system and so on. So that's the opportunity which people are looking out, so that they will harness their ability to to do the fraud. And then the third one, which I will say is, global economics condition and industries across vertical are undergoing big shift, big change for better profits, and its own survival due to competition. So it's a sort of a different type of justification, we can say, a sort of rational. So a pressure for a cause, and an opportunity with an ability, and a rationalization with a judgment will lead us to fraud. And this is what I would like to say when we are talking about an FRM. Ensure you have a fraud risk governance in place. We all understand the meaning of governance here. And a risk assessment periodically happens from a fraud angle. Fraud prevention points have been identified and then deployed, the control measures. And detection points also identified and then deployed, the control measures. And monitoring and reporting at all levels as per the compliance requirements happens systemically. So that will help us to take care of the FRM in a holistic way. With that, any questions? I'll be more than happy to answer.
Thank you, Mr. Natarajan, sir, for your presentation.
Bala.
Mr. Balachandra Natarajan. Yeah, thank you, sir. I think our members are enjoyed this session. Now I request Mr. C.A. Krishnamurthy, please hand over the memento to our speaker.